That's pretty.
Let me try something. I'm curious about something here. I'm wondering if I could shade from the top some of those glares off your belt.
It's really coming out quite nicely. As long as I'm pretty close to it, it's... Just getting the right angle. Who was Nero again? Do you recall? Because I know...
Nero fiddled while Rome burned.
Oh.
That's the tale. So that goes back to the late Roman Empire, say probably, I don't know, 2400 AD. I don't know what place he has in the pantheon of musicians, but...
I mean, even like right down here on the guy's, on Weber's coat, you can see a different pattern. I mean, a series of lines and then lines.
Is that right?
And then there's some squiggles in there to show the tweed coat or whatever.
Is that right?
That's amazing.
That's detail, isn't it?
I mean, the hair looks practically, you know, like pictures.
Uh-huh.
That's amazing. Well, I mean, even more remarkable is, you know, obviously it's silver highlights on top of gold, but like the highlights inside of where the saxophone is gold, while the rest of everything else is silver, and yet they've taken it so closely. Where, how do you know how to do that?
That's, I
don't know.
Real artists.
You can even see a guy's nostril for how small everything is. There's another guy that... Oh, I've forgotten his name now. He does engravings for people on their instruments and tries to reproduce what they did back in the day, but then adds his own... You know, interpretation on top of that. So he's done stuff for Yamaha, I think Jupiter, and they're like this, but obviously not this detailed. And you know, like the entire all the parts on a saxophone engraved.
Yeah,
and it's phenomenal. I've been trying to see if I can get the money up to do a similar engraving like this on a sousaphone.
Oh yeah,
because it's, you know, it'd be something interesting. So how long was this on tour?
It's been on tour more than once. It was built for that exhibition in Kansas City in 24, 25, somewhere there.
Mm-hmm.
It's been out more than several times because they had built a huge plywood box for it, which we used to have, and there was no point in keeping it.
Yes, I saw the case for Purdue's. It's huge.
Sure.
It's weighs more than the instrument. It's... that a British soldier? I mean, that's, you know, some random person there. That's...
Yeah, good question. It's pretty remarkable too how they've framed those pictures with that roll of brass,
mm-hmm.
and how that had to have been heated and rolled out to exact specifications.
Yeah, and routed at the specific area.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. To do that now, it's just it's. Obviously, the old Conn factory.
Yes.
Or one iteration of the old Conn factory.
Yeah, there were several.
Yeah.
I think there were at least two fires.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really major fires.
Yeah, burned the records and their prototype instruments and all that.
Yeah, you see, the thing that is so blatantly stupid about this modern era, modern American business, the outfit that bought Conn promptly trashed it. And in the process, they intentionally threw away all the old dyes and everything.
Really?
Yeah.
That's...
Now, why would you do that?
That makes no sense, because that's...
Stupid. Just okay, this is stupid. So one of the guys was up here 15 years ago or so, who was... We'd been a tuba player in the Army Band. And... First name was Dick, I can't remember his last name right now. And he was actually doing some measurements on one of the instruments, one of the tubas. And I said, what about this tuba here? Yeah, that was a really good tuba. He said, why don't you build one like that? Because all the plans and all the dies have been thrown away. You have to start from scratch, too.
Yeah. Yeah, when I was looking into getting building a bigger Sousaphone or having a company build one, Fred Young pointed me in the direction of Granitz, who pointed me to some small shop in Germany who was evidently building a tuba for someone with a 34-inch bell on it. So a tuba.
Good.
So... I haven't heard anything back from them, or maybe they punched their measurements in wrong, but I converted from millimeters over into inches, and it was 34 inches.
That's a huge tuba bell.
Yeah, so, and they say, you know, they could probably do it if I, you know, took measurements and all that stuff, but they said, you know, if whatever you want, we can do it. So they do everything by hand. Yeah, and even Rudolf Meino, who only makes... 22-inch bells. They get the government to fund their toolings.
Really?
Yeah. They have some contract or something where if they need something really big that's going to be really expensive for them, they can get the government to subsidize for them to get that.
That's interesting.
Yeah. You even have a Sousaphone on here.
Yeah.
That's pretty amazing. All right, is the guy in the center, is he Conn or is he just a person? Because I can't remember what Conn looks like.
This person?
Yes.
That's not Conn.
Or was that like the U.S.?
Yeah.
What was his name?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think he's one of those sort of icons.
Okay.
This is Mr. Conn right up here.
Oh, yeah.
met his grandson when I was down at this conference, by the way.
Wow.
Yeah, Charles Gerhard Conn, the third, I think he was.
Huh.
Conn was, himself, was very wealthy at one time. He kind of squandered his money. But he ran for Congress. He was very much involved in politics. He started a newspaper, which the city of Elkhart still publishes, called the Elkhart Truth.
Mm-hmm.
And he had fabulous boats and houses.
Hmm.
And I think maybe too many wives. Sometimes that could do you in.
Trumpets. I mean, I'm just amazed by the engraving on this.
Are you taking the movie of the whole thing?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, like the detail on the feathers look like a painting. It's.
Mm-hmm.